related to a special interest that they have. Other times you might find that they'll engage you in conversation, but they might be doing this with their body language, and you can't tell if they're actually tuned in. You know, and they might struggle just in terms of their approach, right? So how do we start an introduction with somebody? How do we have those basic small talk moments? You know, what's the weather like today? Those sorts of things. And then, you know, they also tend to struggle sharing their emotions. Not always. Sometimes they're an oversharer, but that's another related issue. And then again, with the restricted and repetitive behaviors, and I'm also forgetting, excuse me, in part A, there's a lot of stuff that I kind of just alluded to with nonverbals being important. So, you know, they may have abnormal eye contact, or their eye contact, so it's either fleeting, and it's, you know, you don't have great eye contact in general, or it's really intense, and it's like a hyper-focused on you. And then you can just think about how nonverbals aren't nicely integrated with the verbals. So again, you know, you might be talking, but you're facing the wrong way, or you're kind of looking off into the distance while talking or listening. So again, just some little mannerisms that vary depending on your kiddos. And then these restricted and repetitive behaviors can be, again, thinking of it as this continuum, you can have the kids that are extremely motor. So they are constantly fidgeting, they're constantly tapping or touching. You know, they might have, I think, this, you know, it's almost like whatever their interest is, it's an abnormal intensity and level of focus. So there's nothing wrong with kids liking Legos, as an example. But if Legos are the only thing that they want to talk about, or animals, yeah, it's very standard for kids to enjoy pets. But if your kid is a huge fan of fish and can tell you about all the different types of bass and all the different types of fishing rods, and, or, you know, just some other fun examples, I had a kid that I worked with who was obsessed with trains and literally could tell you all the time schedules for the trains here in Charlotte. I mean, just so many little nuances where it's not necessarily a bad thing to be interested in, but it's just that intensity that we see. And so you're also gonna get kids that are gonna have the sensory piece too. So sensory processing commonly kind of co-occurs with autism and spectrum. But so, you know, you can think of it as being hypersensitive to taste, texture, sounds, all those things. Or hypo, right? So something that I find interesting, because I work a lot with kids on spectrum, is I love having weighted blankets or weighted objects, and we're going to talk about some of that too. But it's interesting because our nervous system gets kind of heightened, and so when we provide more sensory input with pressure or weight, it actually helps soothe and calm us. And you know, you can think about just getting a hug. A hug feels good, and so. Are you guys familiar with Temple Grandin? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so she, you know, she had her famous hug machine. And so, you know, everybody kind of has their own isms related to it. And so at our office, we like to refer to the spectrum as a lemon continuum. So everybody has their quirks. And so in reality, you know, the next time I make this, I'm probably going to add like a little sliver of a lemon to that glass, because nobody is just a true pure glass of water. We all have our flavor. So just for fun, I love watching dumb YouTube videos of animals, and I could do that for hours. Like, I'm not even joking. Like, I just find animals so entertaining, and that's probably not typical given my age, but, you know, so we all have our little flavors, and so you can think about how, you know, this is going to be a factor for, you know, how our traits or symptoms are showing up and how much they impact our day-to-day lives. And there's a lot of really interesting research too that's coming out now about spectrum in terms of these specific classifications, where you might be able to talk about somebody being spectrum based on their level of motor or the rigidity that they show. And so we're going to see some changes, I'm certain, over the next, you know, decade or so as research continues to change. Also getting a lot better in terms of understanding some of the genetics behind this. So just a way that genes are expressed really differentiates between what's going to happen diagnostically. So, for example, I think it's schizophrenia, bipolar, and autism are extremely similar in terms of their genetic profile, but it's the outcome of the gene, it's called an isoform, so that end product, that really differentiates it, because that end product is what makes certain proteins, and then those proteins are the thing that drives what the issue is. So we're starting to really see kind of some different flavors, and even then, you know, when we think about a lot of the issues that come up with being spectrum, there's a lot of co-occurring stuff. So anxiety is a big one, OCD, so obsessive compulsive, ADHD, you know, I even have seen, I found a trend with seizures being something that's happening. There's a lot of overlap in terms of symptoms, and so that sort of research is really important, not only just in terms of getting better at accurately diagnosing, but considering potential interventions and ways to help prognosis, to help these kids thrive and succeed. So, you know, again, we all have a little lemon in our water, so to speak, and it can go all the way up to a lemon farm in terms of just lots of flavors there. And so, you know, there are some unique challenges that are associated with being spectrum. So as I mentioned, you know, there's this sensitivity with sensories, processing, so whether it's hyper or hypo. These are kids that need some alone time. They need time to decompress, and they often have issues regulating their emotions, and you know, I think that just kind of is what it is. When we think about kids across the lifespan, we would expect younger kids to struggle, but again, it's that intensity that they experience difficulties with what they're feeling. They are also going to struggle with perspective taking, and so we're going to talk about that in terms of some tips to think about. And then pragmatics of language is important, the voice inflection, how you modulate your voice. So just a little ism, so we can think about boys tend to have more of that monotone, monotonous, robotic kind of speech quality. Girls can sometimes have more of a high pitch or like a young baby voice that they'll use. And again, I'm making some generalizations here, because once you've met one Aspie, you've met one Aspie. Let's say those are important things to think about. So abstract language or idioms, you know, the expression, one of the things I like to ask when I do the ADOS, which is a measure specifically for autism, that's considered kind of the gold standard, is we'll do a story, and at the end of the story, it's called Tuesday. It's a great little picture book, and there's just a little bit of language in it, and you see kind of these pigs like flying in the sky, and so then I always love to ask, well, what does it mean when pigs fly, right? What happens when pigs fly? And so that's something that kids on the spectrum might struggle with, or some kids are great with sarcasm and love it, and that's their preferred sense of humor, and then other kids, it goes right over. And then changing routines and adjusting to that is a big thing for our spectrum kiddos. So we'll kind of hit on that as well. And then again, they've got that sort of preoccupation with certain subjects. So I kind of mentioned this already, but I think social anxiety is obviously a really big factor for our spectrum kiddos, whether it's just that anticipatory anxiety where, you know, they're afraid to go and engage and initiate, or it's actually during that moment they have more performance fears, you know, they're worried about what they look like or how they're talking. So those are things to think about. But I also think we really neglect a lot of the strengths that Aspies have. And, you know, again, I really do like to try to focus on strengths and positive qualities within my work with kids. Because, you know, spectrum people have the potential to be wildly successful. And now we're really seeing more of this, especially out in Silicon Valley, where we've got these brilliant, you know, logical, analytical thinkers that are working on computers, and, you know, they're doing a lot of coding, and they don't necessarily have to interact with people that often. And they are doing just fine.
Mm-hmm. Have you read NeuroTribes? I've only read some pages.
It's on my list, yeah. So I haven't gotten to that one yet.
The premise is that this guy who writes for Wired magazine, mm-hmm, goes out to visit friends in Silicon Valley, and he's at a dinner party, and one of the good friends who works in Silicon Valley has a daughter with Asperger's.
Mm-hmm.
Then he goes to another party like the next day, and he has another colleague with a child.
Mm-hmm.
And so he started noticing like these pockets of professionals with students, with children on the spectrum.
Yeah.
And then it just goes back to maybe some genetic predisposition.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
One of the guys that discovered or anticipated the financial crisis in the real estate was an Aspie that he didn't learn until later in life, but he was one of the few people that actually read all the prospectuses and knew that people were going to default.
Yes.
And like he went back and like just spent hours reading those and was like, this is going to happen.
But see, but that's really so beautiful. They're really good at sometimes identifying patterns. And so when you think about kind of helping these kids learn how to interact with their world, it's a lot about scripts, right? So, you know, just figuring out some standard phrasing, how do we get by, and then eventually they'll figure it out and they're gonna make mistakes. And I think that's something to really encourage in a lot of ways, because when we make a mistake, it really sticks out in our mind. Because, so classic example is, you probably don't remember all the times you got an A on a test, but you remember the time you failed, or you remember the time you forgot your project at home and parent didn't bring it for you. So those moments when, you know, as a parent, you might want to swoop in to save them, you know, help them when you can, but it's also, you don't want to make sure, you want to limit how much lifting you're doing for them. And that's something in terms of resiliency, and I could go down a whole nother bunny trail with that. But another thing too that's kind of related to this is, you know, a lot of spectrum people, so particularly Asperger's, tend to have normal to above average intelligence. Oftentimes they are very intelligent. And we'll see a lot more with visual spatial skills as opposed to the verbal skills. These individuals might have wild vocabulary, but then their processing speed is very slow, which can be extremely frustrating, which also might contribute to issues with emotions and self-regulation. So, you know, I think there's a lot of things that we consider as faults or negative things, but we really do have a lot of strengths with these kids. Especially because, you know, one of my favorite things is they just say the truth. They really do, and sometimes that can be savage, as some of my kids like to say. It is savage.
Yeah.
But they, you know, they will tell you what is real and give you sometimes a more accurate perspective on something. So, you know, I think it's just good to kind of consider that. Now, there are some very clear gender differences that I want to highlight. So, there's a variety of things associated with this. So the standard ratio for what we consider, you know, just how I have it presented up here, would be one girl to every four boys on the spectrum. 4 to 1 is technically how they do it, male to female, 4 to 1. And, you know, there are a lot of issues in terms of bias that is not accounted for within measurements. So just as an example, a lot of the norms for these measures that we use are created with predominantly male populations. And actually, it's funny, so I'm doing a talk later today for my practice, for continuing education, on the differences between male and female Aspies. Because the reality is, you know, even with the repetitive behaviors, so our spectrum girls, they're not gonna do the classic lining things up. They might be pacing. Even then, their interests are not necessarily considered atypical for a girl. That's where that intensity and the level is something that you have to pay close attention to. So, you know, girls are gonna be obsessed with animals, or maybe a favorite TV show, and they're always talking about the characters, or they have a celebrity crush, but it's, or even fashion, right? So things that might feel appropriate for a female, but again, there's flavors of it that are different. And so it's hard, it's like once you put your finger on it and you're like, aha, that doesn't make sense in terms of, you know, yes, girls like this, but not to that extent. Horses would be a great example. So I've got several girls that are just obsessed with riding, and so they're lot of things that go hand in hand with that, where, you know, there's a great relationship with the horse. They get to take care of it. There's a lot of movement, which can get at some of that sensory piece. So that's something to think about. And related to this measurement piece too, girls tend to get diagnosed a little bit later than boys. So boys have more of their issues in terms of early childhood, where they're getting flagged more at that point, as opposed to girls are getting identified a little bit later, because there's a couple of different theories. One of the popular ones is this idea of camouflaging. When you think about girls in general, in terms of how we're socialized, it's, you know, in the beginning we're taking in maybe the stray bird or, you know, the odd duck. And then once we get to middle school, then puberty kicks in and cliques start to form. And then those girls that were previously kind of taken in, they start to get left out. And so then we start to see more issues pop up in terms of their socialization. Another thing too is girls tend to just be better in general with imitating social situations. And there's some stuff, you know, potentially within the brain related to that. Again, how we socialize our girls is a factor. And boys, tend to have more obvious and mature social play. Their behavior is a little bit more externalizing. They're bigger, louder. And then girls might be viewed as shy or quiet. And those are just, again, those standard biases that we have within how we view our different gendered kids. So eye contact again is a factor here. So for girls who don't make a lot of eye contact, they might be shy. But then boys, we're viewing that as, well, why aren't you making eye contact? You know, that's a weakness. If that's something that, you know, something's going on here. And then, you know, again, just related with the interest piece, I get so many like weather and trains and other things. Fish is one of my favorite examples. So there's just some nuances that I think are really important to be aware of, that it's not always going to be as clear for girls, and I think that's the takeaway, but they do fall into some of these patterns. But what's awesome is that we're starting to have a lot more research come out now to support changing how we're looking at girls in terms of diagnosis, you know, prognosis, all those things. So I'm going to spend the rest of our time on tips. So before I do that, do you guys have any questions about any of the things I just